Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, Brian Lin has a report on how artificial intelligence may help improve weather predictions. Ana Mateo presents this week's Health and Lifestyle report. And we close the show with the lesson of the day. But first,
weather researchers are using artificial intelligence, AI systems to improve existing weather prediction methods. But experts say the AI tools currently face limitations and should be used along with traditional prediction methods to be most effective. AI systems trained to predict or forecast weather events are now being used by many government agencies and organizations worldwide. Such systems aim to produce weather predictions faster and at a lower cost than traditional forecasting methods. One weather predicting system that has shown promise is the Google-financed GraphCast method. This machine learning-based system trains directly on weather data that has already been collected and examined. Such methods have demonstrated an ability to outperform traditional forecasting systems. The system works by combining past weather predictions with modern forecasting models to provide the most complete picture of weather and climate. In Europe, the European Center for Medium Range Weather Forecasts, ECMWF, has been using AI prediction tools since January. The organization provides detailed weather forecasts 4 times per day to nations across Europe. The ECMWF technology is called the Artificial Intelligence Integrated Forecasting System, AIFS. The group describes the system as a data-driven forecasting model. It is designed to make many predictions quickly, including for extreme events involving powerful storms and heat waves. AI-supported data from the ECMWF correctly predicted intense rains last month across parts of Europe that resulted in widespread flooding. But while the predictions were right, destruction caused by the flooding could not be avoided. Experts told Reuters this is largely because it is still difficult to gather and fully utilize some collected weather data. In addition, there is a need to strengthen and improve current AI models used to predict weather. Andrew Charlton Perez is a professor of meteorology, the scientific study of weather processes at the University of Reading in Britain. He told Reuters, "In some cases and for some variables, AI models can beat physics-based models, but in other cases, vice versa." Charlton Perez said one problem is that the effectiveness of an AI model is based on the information it is given. Weather disasters can be harder to predict if there is too little data to enter into AI systems. This can also be true if extreme events happen repeatedly at different times of the year or in different areas. Charlton Perez said he thinks the best use of AI-based weather forecasts would be to use them in combination with traditional weather predicting tools. This, he noted, could utilize AI data to produce weather predictions based on large sets of information collected from multiple sources. Thomas Vostel is with the weather observatory Geosphere in Austria. He told Reuters his group's models correctly predicted 300 to 400 millimeters of local rains in September, and records show that same amount actually fell in the storms. But scientists say even in cases where predictions are correct, effective communication is needed to get the information out to communities and local officials so they can effectively prepare. Shruti Nath is a research assistant in weather prediction and climate at Britain's Oxford University. She told Reuters, "I think what happened with the recent floods is that it's so rare, a 1 in 150 to 200-year event, that even if the weather models capture it, there's a reasonable degree of uncertainty." Nath said AI-supported forecasts need to be clearly communicated to the public in a way that warns of the severity and possible destruction of extreme events. This way, people might see the importance of taking action before severe weather happens in order to prevent costly cleanup and recovery efforts. I'm Brian Lynn.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Health and Lifestyle Report. A rare look inside the human brain might help to explain how it clears away waste. Scientists say the failure to clear away such waste can lead to Alzheimer's disease and other brain disorders. Brain cells use a lot of nutrients. This means they produce a lot of waste. Scientists believe the brain has special structures to take out this cellular trash, especially during sleep. They have reported observing this process happening in mice. But they had no clear evidence that this happens in humans. Recently published research appears to have identified a system, or network, of very small waste-clearing channels in the brains of living humans. The researchers used a special kind of imaging technology to study the network. One of the researchers was Dr. Juan Piantino of Oregon Health and Science University. Piantino said the new research was important evidence. "We needed this piece to say this happens in humans too," he said. His team recently published its findings in Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. The brain is very active during sleep. During sleeping hours, the brain appears to clean itself. That idea has gotten the attention of researchers. Losing a good night's sleep can cause people's thinking to be unclear. But a continuous lack of sleep is believed to increase the risk of the brain disorder dementia. How does the brain clean itself? Over 12 years ago, scientists at the University of Rochester first reported finding a network they named the glymphatic system. Fluid from the brain, called cerebrospinal fluid, travels through channels surrounding blood vessels to carry waste out of the brain. Beta amyloids are substances linked to problems in the brain, including Alzheimer's disease. When scientists injected mice with beta amyloids, the substance left the brain faster when the animals were sleeping. It is not clear exactly how the system works. However, some research has shown that the movement of blood vessels might help move the waste-clearing fluid where it needs to go. Finding the system in humans is not easy. Regular MRI scans can show some of the fluid-filled channels, but Piantino said the scans do not show their purpose. To find out more, his team at Oregon Health and Science University injected a substance called a tracer into 5 patients. The tracer lit up during MRI scans. 24 to 48 hours later, the tracer material was seen moving through the brain using the channels, as in the earlier research on mice. Rochester's Dr. Maiken Nadergaard predicts that the study will increase interest in how brain waste clearance connects to people's health. But to test if better sleep or other treatments might really increase waste clearance and improve health, researchers have to be able to measure glymphatic function in people, said Dr. Jeff Iliff. He is with the University of Washington and has helped lead waste clearance research. The question is whether the new study might point to ways of measuring the process. Sleep is not the only question. For example, animal studies show that a blood pressure drug now used to treat the stress disorder called PTSD might improve glymphatic clearing. Iliff and Dr. Elaine Peskin plan to study this drug in a group of patients. Larger studies in healthy people are also needed. In addition, Piantino, who used tracer chemicals in people, wants to find an easier, non-invasive test to follow the waste clearance. We cannot study all the questions by injecting people, he said. And that's the Health and Lifestyle Report. I'm Ana Mateo.
Ana Mateo is here now to talk more about this week's Health and Lifestyle Report. Hi, Ana. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for inviting me, Ashley. I am glad to be here.
This week's report centered on our brains and sleep. I was wondering, could you explain for our listeners just what happens with our brains as we sleep?
As it turns out, while we sleep, our brains are hard at work. Researchers have found that while we sleep, the brain may be busy cleaning out built-up waste. They have observed this sleep-time cleaning process in mice, but not in humans. New research may prove that it happens in us as well. Researchers appear to have found small waste cleaning networks in our brains, and they seem to be most active when we sleep.
So it sounds like more research might be needed.
Yes, one of the researchers in the study said that their findings will lead to more studies.
And when we talk about cleaning waste from the brain, what kind of waste are we talking about?
The researchers explained that brain cells use a lot of nutrients. So this means they produce a lot of waste. Scientists call it cellular trash.
Why is this important? What effects can a lack of sleep have on us?
Oh, it affects us in so many ways. Losing a good night's sleep can cause our thinking to be unclear. It can affect our emotions. But a continuous lack of sleep is believed to increase the risk of the brain disorder dementia.
So it sounds like a good night's sleep is extremely important. I will be sure to remind my two young children that their parents need good sleep, and so do they.
Yes, tell your children you need your sleep.
Thanks for joining me today, Anna, and I wish you many good nights of sleep.
Thanks for having me, and I'll keep you updated on future research.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. The U.S. Supreme Court voted that it is unconstitutional to deny children an immigration based on their immigration status. Conservative politicians in several American states have been questioning whether immigrants without legal residency should have the right to a public education. Jill Robbins brings us a report on that issue tomorrow. Listen to tomorrow's podcast or visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Is Anna Mateo.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And my name is Jill Robbins. You're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In lesson 38, we meet Anna's best friend from her hometown. Penelope comes to visit Anna in Washington, D.C. Let's listen.
Hello, I have great news. My best friend from my hometown is coming here to Washington, D.C. I can't wait to catch up with her. Oh, I gotta go. Her train arrives in 10 minutes. Penelope! Penelope!
Anna! I am really happy to see you.
Me too. How was your trip?
I was fine.
Let me help you with your bags.
I'm really excited to be in Washington, D.C. I can't wait to hear about everything.
Penelope, I have so much to tell you. Let's go to my apartment. We can talk over a hot cup of tea.
Anna says she can't wait to catch up with Penelope. That's a phrasal verb that means to learn what someone has been doing in the recent past. Andrew, when was the last time you met an old friend, and what did you do?
Well, by coincidence, just 6 days ago, this last weekend, I met with an old friend with whom I used to teach. And this friend loves Washington, D.C. and all the museums. So we went to the wonderful East Wing of the National Gallery of Art, and we walked around, and then we had wonderful Mexican food. It was a great day.
I went to a high school reunion last year. I met some of my classmates I haven't seen in 50 years. I brought my yearbook, and we looked at our old photos and caught up with what we've been doing since graduation.
Indeed, it is fun to catch up. Now, let's listen and find out what Anna tells her friend about her new life in Washington, D.C.
I love your apartment building, Anna. Is your rent expensive?
Well, I have a roommate, so we split the rent.
Oh, that's right. Is your roommate nice?
Marcia is the nicest person I know in this city. Sometimes she worries too much, and she says I'm the messiest cook she knows. But we are great roommates.
So, Anna, is it hard to make friends in D.C.?
At first, it was hard. But now, Marcia is a good friend. And there's Pete. Of all the people I know in D.C., Pete is the most serious. And also the silliest.
He sounds interesting.
Mm-hmm. Jonathan and Ashley are two other good friends of mine. In the city, they are the friendliest people I know. They always help me when I need it.
Your friends sound great. So, tell me about your job.
Anna has made some good friends, hasn't she? We hear some superlatives here. Nicest, friendliest, messiest, and silliest.
You're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast from Voice of America. We've talked about superlative adjectives in an earlier podcast, but in this lesson, there are some words that change their spelling when we add the suffix est. One is messy, which means not neat or tidy. The final letter, Y, changes to I when we add the EST.
Right, and the same thing happens with the words friendly and silly. Let's listen to more of the story. What do you think Anna will tell Penelope about her job?
I love my work. I make a children's show called The Time Traveling Treehouse.
Anna, that is the best job for you. Do you remember when we were little? We played in that old treehouse behind my family's house for hours.
It is really good to talk to you. New friends are good, but old friends are the best.
Ah, now we know where that idea came from. Anna's childhood games. Jill, do you remember that old expression? Make new friends, but keep the old?
Yes, I do. I think it's a song. One is silver and the other gold. That means friends are valuable, whether they're new friends or old friends. You know, at the end of this lesson, we get a hint of what may be coming in the next Let's Learn English series. Anna invites Penelope to come and live in Washington, D.C.
I know. Our hometown isn't the same now. You are not there.
No crying. No crying. Penelope, why don't you move here and live with me and Marcia?
Anna, I can't leave our hometown. You forget. I love my job, too.
I didn't forget. You are the most famous turkey farmer I know.
Thanks, Anna.
Come on, let's go eat dinner at one of DC's most famous restaurants. Awesome! I have a great apartment, I love my work, and I have awesome friends. I am the luckiest woman in Washington, DC! Until next time.
I noticed another kind of superlative there. But in this kind, we do not add the suffix EST. Instead, we use the most, as in,
you are the most famous turkey farmer I know.
Wow, you know, my nephew and his wife are turkey farmers. Since this podcast is coming out around the holiday of Thanksgiving, when we eat a lot of turkey, let's give a shout out to turkey farmers and the hard work they do.
Okay, we'll do that. And a shout out means we'll just call attention to them. Jill, I was trying to explain why some adjectives don't add EST for the superlative.
Oh, sorry. Just make that little rewind sound, Andrew, and we can replay what I said in podcast 27.
Yep.
When the adjective is longer, usually two or more syllables, we just put the two words the most or the least before it.
Thanks, Jill. One exception to the rule. Sorry, listeners, you should know by now that English grammar rules have a lot of exceptions. One exception is the word friendly. It is two syllables, but it can still add the EST to make the superlative, friendliest.
Some other superlative adjectives that take the most are dangerous and difficult. For example, raising turkeys is the most difficult job my niece does.
I think that's enough about turkeys, Dr. Jill. Let's get our listeners involved here. When was the last time you caught up with an old friend? What did you do together? How long had it been since you last saw each other? Please write to us at learningenglish@voanews.com or in the comments on our YouTube video.
Remember, you can find us on Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, or our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. We hope you have enjoyed the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast.
Thanks for listening.
Thanks for listening. I'm Dr. Jill, and I'm going to make some pies now for our Thanksgiving dinner tonight. That turkey's going to be so yummy.
Well, save some for me, Jill. I'm Andrew Smith.
And that's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.